This video was sponsored by KenHub. More on them at the end of the video.
Hello and welcome. My name is Patrick, and in this video, I'll teach you some of my tips and tricks for remembering all of the skeletal muscles of the head and face that you would see in an anatomy class. And to make this lesson more manageable for beginners, I'll present the list in smaller chunks of 4 to 8 muscles. You can find a list of the sections and timestamps in the description below. And with that out of the way, let's get into the muscles. Now, to remember all of these muscles, we're going to take advantage of one fact. Anatomists are really boring when it comes to naming things. They'll usually take things like the region, position, or shape of the muscle and combine it with a Latin root. And our first chunk of muscles, the forehead, has some great examples. The Latin root for forehead is frontal, and this big wide muscle on the front of your forehead is named the frontalis, which raises your eyebrows and helps with facial expressions. In a similarly predictable naming pattern, the occipitalis covers the back part of your skull, the occipital region. But a small caveat, some anatomists actually classify the frontalis and occipitalis into one continuous occipitofrontalis muscle, since they share a big band of connective tissue called the gallia aponeurotica. Either way, if you remember your anatomical regional terms, then the muscles fall into place. Now, some muscles get their name from their shape as well as their location. Like, that frontalis muscle actually inserts on another muscle, the orbicularis oculi muscle, which I remember because it circles or orbits the eye and allows you to close your eyelids. It's one of those muscle names that has both the shape and location in its name, making it predictable to identify. Meanwhile, the next two muscles are named after their action. The corrugator supercilii and the depressor supercilii both have actions in their names, but you'll notice that the last part, supercilii, refers to a piece of anatomy, in this case, the superciliary arch, the bony bump that you can feel behind your eyebrows. So these muscles move your eyebrows somehow. I remember these because the corrugator sits high and medial, which lets you furrow your eyebrow and make an angry face. And I don't know about you, but corrugator sounds like a very angry supervillain. And if the corrugator were real, they'd probably be angry all the time and keep that furrowed brow. Meanwhile, the depressor supercilii is smaller and tucked within the orbicularis oculi muscle. Some anatomists just consider it to be part of the orbicularis oculi, while others consider it a separate muscle, but regardless, it attaches to the superciliary arch, which helps us remember it. The next chunk is made of the muscles that move the eye, or the extraocular muscles. And while there are 8 names here, we can actually chunk them up even further. 4 of them are rectus muscles. And when we see rectus in muscle names, think of muscles that pull in a straight line, like the rectus abdominis, rectus femoris, or the rectus oculi muscles in the eye. These things point the eye in one of 4 directions. So the superior rectus oculi points the eye up, the inferior rectus oculi points down, and the medial and lateral rectus point it left and right. So to remember these, find those straight muscles that attach to the eye and just substitute directional terms. The 2 oblique muscles of the eye follow a similar pattern. In the language of anatomy, oblique just means slanted, neither parallel nor perpendicular. And both the obliquus oculi superior and obliquus oculi inferior use pulleys made of connective tissue to attach to the eye at a slanted angle. That's it for the muscles that move the eye, but there are some that move the eyelid, which includes another example of just boring naming conventions, the levator palpebrae superioris. It's a mouthful, but each word gives us a clue to its function. It's a levator, so we know that it lifts. We know that superior means up, closer to the top of the head, and you guessed it, palpebrae means eyelid. Finally, you might also see the superior tarsal muscle described with the extraoculars. It hooks up to the base of the levator palpebrae to raise the upper eyelid. Once again, we've got that directional term, superior, but we've also got tarsal, which you probably know as foot. And in this case, you have to think of it like the foot of the eyelid. Next up are the ear muscles, some of which are actually remnants of evolution. Very few people can voluntarily flex these muscles and move their ears. On the sides of our skulls, attached to the outer ear, are the auricularis muscles, and there are 3 of them, auricularis anterior, auricularis superior, and auricularis posterior. They're straightforward to remember, literally directional terms plus auricularis, which is the regional term for ear. But once we get into the ear, we find 2 more muscles, including the smallest muscle in your body, the stapedius, named because it stabilizes one of those small ear bones, the stapes. You'll also find the tensor tympani here, which attaches the auditory tube to the malleus, another one of those tiny ear bones. And despite its name, it doesn't directly attach to the tympanic membrane, or eardrum, but it does protect the eardrum by pulling on the malleus, which then puts tension on the tympanic membrane and protects you from loud noises. That's my memory device for this one. The final muscle in this chunk is the temporoparietalis. As the name implies, it sits somewhere between the temporal and parietal regions of the skull and attaches to the ear. Next up, the nose muscles. You probably saw this one coming, but they mostly share one Latin root, nasal. The most prominent are the two muscles that control the nostrils, the transverse nasalis and the alar nasalis. The transverse portion spans the entire width of the nose, transversing from edge to edge. Meanwhile, I'm using my Latin roots and know that alar, or alar, means wings, and that the alar nasalis is tucked away on the edges of the nose like little wings. And as far as function, there are really only two things that we can do with our nostrils, dilate them or compress them. The alar nasalis dilates when the transverse compresses. You can use the acronym DACT if you like. Dilation, alar, compression, transverse. But as far as location, both nasalis muscles have it built in. On top of the nasalis muscle is the long procerus muscle, another Latin giveaway since it means tall or extended. You could also remember it because it reminds you of the proboscis monkey with the big nose. Whatever you like though, it's also sometimes called the pyramidalis nasi, which is, easy enough, the pyramid-shaped muscle on your nose. Moving down the face, you'll find the depressor septi nasi, which has the memory device built into the name. It depresses, or pulls down, the septum, or middle part of the nose. So you'll find this one centered right under the nose. Finally, the muscle with the longest name of any muscle in the body, the levator labii superioris aliquae nasi, or LLSAN. But despite how long it is, it's another literal translation. It lifts the upper lip, the labii superioris, and the wings of the nose, or aliquae nasi. It runs from the zygomatic arch all the way down to your upper lip, so it spans a lot of anatomy. The next chunk is the biggest of the facial region, the mouth muscles. Our mouths are super expressive, so we have a bunch of tiny muscles that tweak it in a bunch of different ways. The most superficial muscles are these long guys, the zygomaticus major and minor. They both originate at the zygomatic arch, or upper cheek, and head to the mouth, which is how I remember these muscles. But these are the first major and minor pair we've seen in this series so far. Those terms just correspond to size, though. The zygomaticus major is bigger than the zygomaticus minor. Now, some of the other muscles go back to intuitive action, region, and naming conventions, like the levator labii superioris. It lifts the upper lip. Meanwhile, the depressor labii inferioris pulls the bottom lip down. These two muscles have kind of broad, general lip area insertions. On the other hand, the levator anguli oris and depressor anguli oris attach at the angle or corners of the mouth. Again, the name tells you everything. The levator lifts the angle of your mouth while the depressor pulls it down, although some anatomists have different names for them. The depressor anguli oris is sometimes called the triangularis because it's triangle shaped, I guess, I don't really see it. And the levator is called the caninus, or caninus, because it's where those big canine teeth would be. Then, my favorite muscle name to say, the buccinator, which is the main muscle of the cheek. It connects everything from the maxilla, the mandible, and the mouth together, so it's less of a chewing or biting muscle and more of just a general cheek muscle, allowing us to push air out of our mouth when it's filled up. In fact, some people have nicknamed it the trumpet or bugle muscle because of that function. So you can always remember bugle, buccinator. Around the mouth is also the orbicularis oris, which has the same naming structure as the orbicularis oculi we saw in the eye. Orbicularis means that it's a muscle that encircles or orbits an entire structure, and oris means oral, so the orbicularis oris is the muscle that encircles the mouth. Then there's the risorius, this muscle that goes from the corner of your mouth to somewhere in the general vicinity of the zygomatic area. The bulk of the muscle belly comes off the corner of your mouth, but where it goes after that is different from person to person. And the only way that I remember this one is because it looks like the Joker's scars from The Dark Knight. And laughter, in Spanish and French, both start with RI, just like risorius. So this is the Joker muscle to me. Also, I think Dark Knight came out in like 2008, so if you're too young to get that reference, finish this video and then go watch that movie. It's really good. Next up are the muscles of mastication, or chewing. There aren't a ton of muscles here, but they have some interesting names, so I wanted to keep it simple. The first is the masseter, and knowing that mastication means chewing, the masseter literally translates to the chewing muscle, and it's exactly where you think it would be, on your cheek connecting the skull to the jaw. If you bite down, you can feel this one pop up big time. Likewise, you can feel another one of those chewing muscles, the temporalis, over your temple. The other two muscles are smaller and deep to the masseter. They're the lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid. The medial version is actually behind the jaw and skull and is more visible from the inside, whereas the lateral pterygoid is a small muscle that's more superficial and sits right between the skull and jaw. I remember these because pterygoid sounds like you ate something, you're saying, that's really good, that's pterygoid. It's really dumb also, but you're gonna remember it. Moving on to the last chunk in the head unit, the tongue. And the tongue muscle can even be further divided into four intrinsic muscles that change the shape of the tongue and a bunch of extrinsic muscles that move the tongue within the mouth. Now, you'll notice a pattern with the names for the extrinsic muscles. They all end in glossus, which is the Latin root for tongue. Then the prefix gives you the hint as to where it attaches. Like a clear example, the styloglossus is a long muscle that connects the styloid process on the skull to the tongue, or the palatoglossus, which attaches the soft palate to the tongue. Told you, there's a clear pattern with these. And the hyoglossus is this wide muscle that attaches the tongue to the hyoid bone. Some anatomists say that a portion of this muscle is an entirely separate muscle called the chondroglossus, a muscle that attaches to the same spots as the hyoglossus, but is separated by fibers from another muscle. But if it's not on your list of muscles to memorize for the class, don't worry about it. The final extrinsic tongue muscle is the genioglossus, this wide, fanning muscle behind your bottom front teeth responsible for sticking out your tongue. I remember this one because genial, or nice, people don't usually stick out their tongue when they smile. The intrinsic muscles follow a different pattern. They're named after the direction that their fibers take instead of where they attach. So the verticalis are the vertical fibers of the tongue, up and down, while the transversus are the fibers that run side to side. And of course, the tongue is a long organ, so it has a set of longitudinal fibers that run front to back. The superior longitudinal muscle is the most superior or topmost fibers of the tongue. All of the mucosa, taste buds, and nerve endings are on top of that. Then the inferior longitudinal muscle is underneath that. Now, these are just the tricks that I personally use to remember these muscles, but if you want another great resource for learning anatomy, then you need to check out KenHub. I use them all the time when researching and writing these videos, and for this series in particular, their written articles and atlas of muscles have been extremely helpful in refreshing my knowledge of some of those deeper, smaller muscles. They've also got an enormous library of in-depth videos about muscles, histology, vasculature, nerves, and everything else you'd need to know in anatomy class. All those beautiful illustrations that you saw in this video came from them. And in addition to their library of content, I also love KenHub's quiz feature. They allow you to build custom quizzes with different difficulties, and they give you feedback so you can figure out where your weaknesses are. You can use most of KenHub's features for free, but if you want full access to all of their learning content and quizzes, then go to khub.me/corporis to get 10% off your subscription. They've also got a no questions asked 7-day money back guarantee, so you can try out the premium version for 7 days, and if you don't like it, get your money back. If you want to see the next video in the muscle memorization series, then check out this playlist here. Otherwise, subscribe, leave a like on the video, have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.